Support for the Pitch Talks podcast provided by the good beer folks at Steam Whistle, makers of Canada's premium Pilsner. Why not stop by the brewery before or after the game for a sample or a six-pack? Hey, everybody. Homestand Sports presents Pitch Talks. Today on Pitch Talks, the comebacker. Yeah, we're talking the second most popular ball team in Canada, the Montreal Expos. Will they return? Some people think so, and sooner than you can imagine. Je t'aime, today on Pitch Talks.
We interrupt this program to bring you an urgent Pitch Talks bulletin.
Hey, this is Kevin Kennedy, the founder of Pitch Talks. Just jumping in here real quick to tell you about our next show in Toronto coming up on Thursday, April the 7th. We're back at the Phoenix Concert Theater, and we've got a stacked lineup of speakers, including Blue Jays president Mark Shapiro, Dan Shulman from ESPN Sunday Night Baseball, Buck Martinez, former Jays GM Gord Ash, Dave Cameron from Fangraphs, and of course, our pals Arden Zwelling, Ben Nicholson-Smith, and Christina Rutherford from Sportsnet. Ticket info will be up on our site at homestandsports.com later this week, but sign up for our newsletter for first dibs on those tickets. And now, back to the show.
Thanks for downloading the Pitch Talks podcast. I'm your host, Kevin Hilliard. This week's show has its origins from one fan's question at a recent live Pitch Talks.
There's been a little bit of talk here and there. Stephen Brofman obviously leading the charge to try and bring the Expos back. And what are the odds that's going to happen anytime soon so my son can go to a game with me? Thank you.
That is the question, one that legions of Expos fans have been asking repeatedly for over a decade. Quite frankly, the question has been ringing in the ears of Canadians so loudly and for so long that I'm kind of shocked that it's only been 12 years. Usually this kind of yearning would take decades and decades to build up. But that's Montreal, a passionate city filled with passionate fans. And just like an old flame calling you back, the Expos somehow still have a hold on the city of Montreal. Today you still see the old red, white, and blue Expos logo everywhere in the city, a sign that fans have clearly not given up on their former love. Montreal Mayor Denis Coderre has also been fanning the flames of a possible comeback recently by meeting with MLB Commissioner Rob Manfred. And former fan fave Warren Cromartie started the Montreal Baseball Project back in 2012 with the ultimate goal being to bring Major League Baseball back to La Belle Provence. So, what do you suppose it'll take to get the Spos back? Today on the podcast, we're going to hear from some of our Pitch Talk panelists, including ESPN's Dan Shulman, Jonah Keri from the Jonah Keri Podcast and author of the Expos book Up, Up, and Away, and former Expos PR man and current Toronto Star columnist Richard Griffin. But before we talk about the future of baseball in Quebec, let's kick the show off with former Expo Dave Palmer, recorded live at Pitch Talks in Montreal. He speaks to how special it was being an Expo back in the glory years of the franchise.
But my first experience with the Montreal Expos was when Jerry Park. And we would always try to find out when Steve Rogers was pitching.
Because you're from upstate New York, correct?
That's right, about 2.5 hours down the road. So I was a Montreal Expo fan when they started out. Felipe was the guy that, and it wouldn't happen in today's world. You know, you have to be in the right place at the right time, and you have to have a lot of luck. In 1976, I was 0-5 with a 7.2 ERA in rookie ball. The next year, I go to West Palm as a non-roster player. I'm throwing on the side in the bullpen in Pompano Beach. Bobby Ramos is catching me. He just got sent down from Big League camp. After I'm done, he comes up to me in front of Jim Fanning, Bob Gebhardt, and Felipe and say, "What game are you starting?" I said, "I'm not on the team." He said, "What do you mean you're not on the team? You got better stuff than anybody on the team." Well, 2 days later, they released two older guys, and I got to pitch an inning here. I got to pitch an inning there. The following year, I pitched for him in AA. At the end of the year, John McHale was in Nashville, Tennessee, and he said, "We're going to take one of the pitchers who had a really great year this year to Montreal next week." Well, I had four shutouts in AA, but they took Bob James. He was a number one draft choice at 76. I was a number last. F- Felipe told me after, he said, you're going to be in Montreal before the week's out. He said, trust me, you will be there. So I drive back up to upstate New York, and sitting there, my mother's at the dining room table, and the phone rings. I said, oh, that's Montreal calling me to the big leagues. I'll get it. Answer the phone. David, this is Kevin McHale, Montreal Expos. Steve Rogers is having surgery. We added you to the 40-man roster. How soon can you be here? I said, I can be there in 3 hours. They said, no, how about tomorrow? I said, 3 hours. I don't want you to change your mind. So I know that Felipe got me that call up.
There are very few Expos in the history of the team who grew up cheering for the team.
Right, right. And, you know, and the thing about it is we could not get the games on radio. My dad, God bless him, with a shortwave radio to try to pick up what little bit he could of the telecast, you know, and I still have the spiral notebook where he kept score of all the games I pitched, and there's a few blanks because he couldn't hear it, but that was before, you know, the satellite dishes and the baseball network and all of that. But the great thing about being in Montreal is the day that I got called up, my dad went into the office with me to sign my contract.
Oh, that's awesome.
The second day, I got to get into the game against the Cubs, and my mom and my dad and my grandfather were in the stands. And I don't know that I ever pitched one game in Montreal that my dad was not here. And I would be warming up in the bullpen, and I would hear somebody call my name. I'd look up, and it would be high school classmates. After the game, there would be teachers and coaches, and family was always here. So it was always a home game for me, obviously. And to be able to share my Montreal Expos experience with my family and my coaches and my teachers and my best friends in high school and the community was just awesome. In 79, we kind of overlapped with the Canadians at the tail end of their run of four straight Stanley Cups. So this city was electric. That year, 79, I don't know how many people were there when we were playing Pittsburgh, and there was like 60,000 people in Olympic Stadium, and they brought Rusty Staub out to pinch hit. Does anybody remember that?
I was there.
Okay, I still get goosebumps when I talk about that. And I did a show with Rusty and a bunch of the other guys a couple months ago, and Rusty said that was one of his greatest moments in his 20-year career. Was the ovation that he got when he came back to Montreal. So the fans, everybody was wearing Expo stuff. After, you know, the Canadians won the Stanley Cup, they were, so it's either Canadians or Expos. You didn't see any Red Sox, you didn't see any Yankees. All it was Canadians and Expos. And it was so cool that I would get on the metro to go to the game with people wearing their Expo coats and their Expo hats. You know, and I wore glasses, and I didn't when I pitched, so nobody knew who I was. So that was pretty cool, you know. And people would be on the metro going, "I hope Palmer's not pitching tonight. We got to win this game. I hope Rogers is pitching." But and I told Steve this to his face 2 months ago. Steve Rogers is the best right-handed pitcher I ever saw.
Mm.
And I mean, his stuff. You talk about electric.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Steve was one of those guys, and I kidded about it. Gullickson kidded about him a couple months ago. He'd strike out the side on 9 pitches, which is very rare. And he'd come walking out the field going like this.
Mm.
He was unhappy. I missed by that much on that one slider. That one slider missed by that much. You know, I mean, he was a perfectionist. And like I said, he's the best right-handed pitcher I've ever seen. Ellis Valentine was every bit as good as Andre Dawson. And people do not believe me when I say that. And I said, he could run just about as well as Hawk. He was a better outfielder. He had a better arm. You needed a 3-run homer. He stood up there, and he hit the 3-run homer. I still think Ellis was every bit as good as Andre Dawson, which is obviously saying a lot because Andre's in the Hall of Fame, but that's how much I think of Ellis Valentine. I'm always an Expo fan. When people ask me, what was your favorite team to play on before they finished? Expos.
Yeah.
You know, and if I got to go into the Glens Falls Little League Hall of Fame, I'd want to go in as an Expo.
We'll take it.
This summer, or this fall, I went to Cooperstown, and I'll try to get through this, but looking at Gary's plaque was really hard. And I'm so glad that he has an Expo hat on in Cooperstown and not a Mets hat, because he's a Montreal Expo. You know, and then to go to the next exhibit over and see Hawk, you know, also wearing an Expo hat and not a Cubs hat. And a few petitions over from that, we should see a Timmy Raines Expo hat. The Montreal Expos from 79 through the early 80s, I can only speak for them. We were family, and we're still family. And when I saw Steve Rogers and Rusty Staub and Ellis and those guys a couple months ago, I hadn't seen him in almost 30 years. We picked right up where we left off. And because, and it's not just because of the team, but it was John McHale and Patty McHale. It brought the wives, the families in together, and the city of Montreal took us in and treated us like part of a Montreal family. And it, playing in Montreal is very unique, because Gary and Chris Spire were the only two that lived here. The rest of us came here to play baseball, so we had to bond together. It was just a family. We were family, and it was just a great place to be and a great time to be an Expo.
Now, why did the team leave in the first place? Jonah Keri wrote the book on the subject. Literally. For the full story, check out his massive read with the even more massive title, Up, Up, and Away, The Kid, The Hawk, Rock, Vladdy, Pedro, Le Grand Orange, Yuppie, The Crazy Business of Baseball, and the ill-fated but unforgettable Montreal Expos. Whew. Here's Jonah with a quick history lesson on why the team left, along with his thoughts on baseball returning to his hometown.
It was a matter of degrees. It had to do with the ownership situation, and it was, by then, Jeffrey Loria had taken over, whatever. It wasn't Loria, it wasn't anybody in particular. It was just this kind of gradual, slow fade. Major League Baseball had been talking about relocating the Expos for years. There was actually a movement in the late 80s to move the Expos when Bronfman still owned the team, but he was clearly getting disenchanted, and he'd have conversations with people. And Buffalo, eventually became D.C., but Buffalo was always, it's going to move to Buffalo. I'm like, okay. Buffalo's a fine town, but, you know. And they keep having these conversations or whatever. So it's possible in 01 it could have been saved. A lot of it was, you know, the ownership stuff, but there were also these endemic factors.
What was it? Was the dollar like 65 cents then?
Yes, that was a big problem. And even the economy, like if you think about the U.S. economy in the mid to late 90s, it was insane. I moved to the U.S. in 97 after college. I mean, it was dot-com this, and everybody's making tons of money or whatever. Quebec didn't really have that. And in fact, the Habs went up for sale in the 90s, and nobody in Canada wanted to buy the Montreal Canadiens, which is crazy. But it goes to show that if the Habs took that long to sell, it was really a tough time, what chance did the Expos have? I think that the transfer of ownership and the dollar and the lack of like young entrepreneurs, Quebec wasn't really, now it's more of that, but it wasn't that much then. And a lot of things that need to happen for a city to be vibrant were not there at the exact same time that bad things were happening to the team. It was really like this perfect storm. And if you just roll the dice 99 more times, I'm not sure, maybe once or twice or another that they would move. I really think that they just ran into this just storm of bad circumstances at the same time. This is why I honestly believe that if there was a team hypothetically in the future, that it would probably work, assuming they have good ownership, that it would work, because things have really changed since the time I moved away 17 years ago. It's not a recognizable city anymore. It's totally different. As far as it goes with the business community, I mean, there have been movements, and I've sat on this stage and talked about it, and it's been going on for a while. And the thing about, you know, there was a letter circulated to all 30 teams, and like they told me about it 6 months ago, but I couldn't say anything. Like, and I know things that are going to happen 6 months. I'm not allowed to say things because these nebulous behind the scenes people, take me out for lunch and beers and say, okay, don't say anything, but I'm going to tell you these things. So all I could tell you is that there is real movement going on, and there are people with money and influence and the will to make it happen. That are trying. I'm almost to the point where I'm less concerned about committed ownership in Quebec
than I am about how, what's the mechanism. How is it going to happen for Major League Baseball? Is it going to be relocation? Is it going to be expansion? And if it does happen, when, how? Those are the things that I worry about. I don't want to say that it's a, I take it as a given that somebody's going to write a check for $1 billion, maybe $1.5, probably $1.5. But I think that that's very feasible. And honestly, you know, Bell is at the heart of that. I mean, you want to have that kind of media synergy. You want to have the ability to leverage TV. And so Bronfman coming in with somebody like Bell and lots of other local industries, I mean, that is a real viable threat.
I just think about other cities like Houston drew a bunch this year all right. of a sudden because they became good and other teams did too. And I think that one knock against the city was, oh, well, attendance was bad or whatever. But like there just weren't that many opportunities to support a winner. It seems to me that the universal tenet is that if a winner shows up in any city, including this one, that it can work.
In some ways, a successful team in Toronto, you could argue, is a detriment to a potential team in Montreal. And you know, one of the worst moments for the Expos was in the 80s when the Jays went to Commissioner Bowie Kuhn and said, we want our Southern Ontario TV territory, which the Expos controlled. And the Jays had every right to do that, and it was correct. It was the right ruling by Bowie Kuhn, and it was a death knell for the Expos because now they're out of this market. And that was a real problem. And anytime, that's just basic business stuff. I mean, you know, if the most logical city to expand in baseball by far is putting a third team in New York, like financially, obviously, Brooklyn, Connecticut, doesn't matter. But that would never happen because the Yankees and the Mets would throw a fit and whatever. And so there's always going to be that pissing contest a little bit, quite frankly. And you could argue that works against Montreal. On the other hand, things like the exhibition games, which were put on by the Jays, and they were Jays events, obviously got the attention of Major League Baseball in terms of, oh, maybe this isn't a viable baseball market. I'm not ready to say it's a viable baseball market solely on the fact that there were four games that did well, but it probably meant a little something, and I know that there are people, I know Rob Manfred watched the games, I know that he was interested, and that's fine.
Yeah, you know, location certainly matters. In Montreal, I think it would have mattered to some extent. I think they would have drawn better. The way it works, it's a very Saint-Cassette culture. Saint-Cassette just means 5 to 7. It's a happy hour culture. You go, you work downtown, you drink, you go do something else. Well, they could have walked down the hill from all the office buildings downtown. It would have been fine. But I don't think that would have necessarily been a panacea. I think the allure would start to fade a little bit, and you would have needed something else. I always come back to what was the reason that it didn't really work out. It's just ownership. And, you know, you talk about Rogers and the conspiracy or whatever. Are they doing this or that? Yeah, but Rogers is a well-heeled ownership group that kind of at least cares a little and spends some money. Like, dude, I wish I was a Jays fan. That's amazing. You know, we didn't have that. Charles Bronfman sold the team in the early 90s, and we were owned by big corporations. We, as if I played for the team. The Expos were owned by major corporations, Bell, Canadian Pacific, whatever, but none of them wanted to kick in any money. They all said, here's $5 million, leave us the F alone, and we're done with it. And it was very disheartening, and that's what it came down to. So the ballpark would have helped with the fan experience. It would have helped with the location or whatever, but, I mean, if we're really going to get to it, it just comes down to if you have good ownership. If you don't, it's not going
to
work.
How many of you go to those games in Montreal?
Oh, you should go next year. Come and I'll buy you all beers, for God's sake. So, go! How are you not going? Do you know so about Montreal? It was so fun. And people were legitimately, even the first year, were chanting, Let's Go Blue Jays, which was a little nauseating, but it was cool. Like, it was fun. It was neat. It was a great environment, and the players all dig it, and the media, my God. When the Cincinnati media showed up and said, we get to be in Montreal for the weekend, they lost their minds. They're just, you should go.
That's Jonah Keri, our resident Expos expert. If you ever run into Jonah and have an hour to kill, just ask him if he thinks Tim Raines should be in the Hall of Fame. You'll see. It's time for the seventh inning stretch here on Pitch Talks, but don't you go nowhere. There's plenty more a-brewing. Hey everybody, it's time for the Pitch Plug, brought to you by Homestand Sports. April 7th. Pitch Talks will be in Toronto at the Phoenix Concert Theater. Info and tickets available on our website, homestandsports.com/pitch. And we've got a Hoop Talks March 9th and a Puck Talks March 23rd, both also happening in Toronto, this time at the Frickin' on King. For more info on these shows, head to the mothership, homestandsports.com. Okay, welcome back to Pitch Talks. As Jonah alluded to earlier, for each of the past 2 years, the Jays have had two very well-attended preseason exhibition games in Montreal. Seeing almost 50,000 fans each night for a warm-up series has got to be a good sign for baseball's return to the city. But there is the matter of, say, an owner and a usable stadium. Now, with their take on baseball returning to Montreal, here's Sportsnet's Stephen Brunt, ESPN's Dan Shulman, along with the Pitch Talks version of Statler and Waldorf, the Toronto Sun's Bob Elliott, and the Toronto Star's Richard Griffin. Quick side note, Richard used to be the Expos PR guy in the early 70s, so be sure to hang in till the end of this segment for a quick story simply entitled The Bear Wrestler.
I'm going to be the skeptical guy here.
Please do.
You know, Stephen Bronfman is a fishing buddy of mine. He was part of the consortium there. He had a minority part in the kind of second last ownership of the Montreal Expos against the wishes of his father, Charles Bronfman, the former owner of the Expos, who told him, don't ever buy a baseball team. It's a terrible idea, no matter how rich you are. And I think he would take a small piece, and I think he would try and pull something together, but I don't think he's ever going to be the owner of a Montreal baseball team. And someone is going to have to be. You know, I guess that could be Bell. But
does that person exist right now in Montreal?
Well, Bell could be a big part of it. But you're not just talking about a team. You're talking about a stadium that's going to cost as much as the team, almost. And you got a 75-cent Canadian dollar right now. So it's a big ask. People wishing it would happen, and a mayor who's a promoter and self-promoter of the first order, Denny Coderre. You know, there's a lot of people there who would like to take credit when it happens, but you know, someone's got to write a couple of monstrous checks. Look, I someone's got to build a stadium. You know, so we're in a chicken and egg proposition here. And it's not going to be Tampa, I don't think, because of the lease. I think they will find a solution there and eventually build a stadium on the Tampa side of the bay, somewhere where it makes more sense than the stadium they have now. If Montreal built a stadium, the chances of Montreal getting a baseball team, probably an expansion team, would be very high right now, but I don't think anybody in Montreal is prepared to build a stadium, so I don't see how it's going to happen. And I say that with great regret because, you know, I was there, right? And I covered those teams, and there is nothing better than baseball in Montreal. And for 2 years now, that Jays weekend in Montreal has been the best part of the year. It's been spectacular. I hope some of you guys went. It's just been a blast, and it's got a different vibe than here, as you know. But I just don't see it happening. I would be the happiest guy in the world if it did. You know, and I know Bell, there's the content play for Bell and all of that stuff that we've talked about, but somebody's got to build a $500, $600 million stadium first before they buy the team, and I don't know who that would be.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. Heart says yes, head says no.
Yeah.
15,000 people in Montreal can sound like 50,000 people somewhere else. That's really amazing. Yeah. It's an unbelievable scene. And back in the day when they were really good in the 90s, going to Olympic Stadium was a trip in every sense of the word.
Yeah.
And without getting into this any further, visiting players really miss Montreal.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I have no idea why.
Next question, please.
Well, I certainly hope it happens. And could you imagine the Yankees, the Red Sox, and Toronto coming into the Olympic Stadium or whatever the new park is called when it's built in 2 or 3 years? But I still think they need a white knight. Now, a year ago, November, they had Stephen Bromfman's name was in La Presse. I have not heard anything since. And the other thing I did hear, which I'd forgotten, that Bromfman sued when Montreal left.
Right, and that's never a good thing. But my feeling on that is that when the mayor of Montreal, who's like a foghorn leghorn on the Bugs Bunny thing, I say, in French, whatever that is. Je dis. But when he went to New York to meet the commissioner, my feeling, and this was a couple of months, this was during the middle of the season, my feeling was that the commissioner told him just settle down. And my feeling on baseball getting back to Montreal, whether it's the Expos, whether it's another team, they have a stadium site. It's sort of a rundown area, which I approve of. But in terms of Montreal, I think when the mayor went down to visit the commissioner, my feeling is that the baseball through time has always needed a suitor for a franchise, and that's how they get new stadiums built. And this goes back to the 80s and the 70s. You get a new stadium built by threatening to move somewhere else. So the commissioner says to the mayor, you are the somewhere else, so just shut up and we'll keep you in mind. And if Tampa gets a new stadium built, and if Oakland gets a new stadium built, and if everywhere that needs a new stadium gets it built, we will take you in expansion. And I think that in time, and it's not, there's no time frame on it, that if those cities that need a new stadium get them, the commissioner will remember Montreal for being the other woman. The Rays moving to Montreal would be the greatest thing ever. But expansion, I was there 3 years. I joined the Expos 3 years. It was painful. 3 years into expansion, it was painful, but it was fun. It was great. Fans loved it, and they got to a point where they were one of the best teams in baseball.
Rich, you told me once with the Expos in the early days for opening day, a guy wanted to wrestle a bear. And your question was, you said to him, what if the bear wins?
Yeah, the great Antonio. I was a young PR guy at the time. It was 1978. And the great Antonio showed up. He didn't have the bear with him, but he had pictures. And he said he wants to wrestle a bear between games of a doubleheader. And like he said, he's never lost. Whatever. And like he's a big hairy guy with a tank top and, you know, reasonable arms for no PEDs involved, but... And I asked him, well, this is all great, but what happens if you lose? You know, the second game is going to be a struggle to be played. And he went, the great Antonio never loses. And I said, well, the great Antonio won't be wrestling a bear between games of a doubleheader. And that was it.
Didn't he say the bear was drugged?
Well, yeah, I mean, that was a given.
So to get back to the original question that started this whole podcast off.
What are the odds that's going to happen anytime soon so my son can go to a game with me?
We leave the final word to Jonah Keri.
When? I don't know how old your son is. You don't seem that old. I'm going to guess he's not 72. So I think you're good. I think your son will see a game in his lifetime and hopefully, you know, when he's still a child. And the hope for all of us. Is that at some point, the team will come back, there will be actual success, and we can reminisce and have a good time about it, but we can also talk about the present and about the future. That is really what we're all hoping for, and we'll see what happens.
And that's the ball game and the Pitch Talks podcast for this week. There's a new one coming each Tuesday whilst we are in season, so please take time to subscribe to us on iTunes, and even better, leave us some feedback. Good. Or even not so good. Either way, take a second to help us out. It's much appreciated. For more Pitch Talks live dates, head to homestandsports.com/pitch. And you can find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, where we are simply known as, you guessed it, Pitch Talks. Finally, please ship all questions and comments to podcasts@homestandsports.com. I'm your host, Kevin Hilliard. Good night, everybody. The Pitch Talks love theme is by Steve Kreklo at KreCklo on Twitter. Music this week by Steve Kreklo and Todor Kobakov at KOBOKOV on Twitter. The Expo's organ theme performed by Fernand Lapierre. Pitch Talks is a Homestand Sports production.